The next, we move to the next speaker with Pavel Janos. Pavel, are you?
Yes, I'm here.
Yes, so you have to share.
Yes.
Let's see. Yeah, it looks like it's working.
Okay, perfect. So, greetings, everybody. My name is Pavel Janos. I am.
Sorry, Pavel, you have about 25 minutes, so just to.
I will try to keep in the time limit. Okay. So, greetings. My name is Pavel Janos. I'm postdoc in the group of Alessandra Magistrato here in Sierra IOM within CISA. And my talk will be, applicational talk. You will not hear anything really interesting or useful.
Pavel, sorry, your voice sounds a little bit like, maybe you can put the mic closer, I don't know.
No, maybe far away, I think.
It looks like you are far away, yes.
No, but I think the opposite, no? It's just, it's, try maybe.
Is this good or?
Not the idea, but okay, maybe.
But I'm limited by the laptop microphone, so I don't know what to.
Ah, well, okay, go ahead. Maybe it's okay. No, okay, go ahead. Sorry.
Okay, so I will talk about one of our application projects that we did in the group regarding NKCC1 ion cotransporter. And I put a bit of a spoiler in the subtitle in the four ions one channel. So let's go. So to introduce the NKCC. Stands for sodium potassium chloride cotransporter. It is a membrane transporter that transports chloride, sodium, and potassium ions across cellular membranes, and it does so in the 2-1-1 stoichiometry. So it transforms two chlorides, one sodium and one potassium. It is schematically shown here, and it is a very very important transporter. It plays a role in various biological processes. It regulates the homeostasis of these ions, which then is linked to the cell volume regulation, and so on and so on. And we, in mammalian organism at least, we recognize two isoforms, the NKCC1, which we are more interested in, which is ubiquitously expressed in pretty much all tissue, and find it in basolateral membranes of organs, in inner ear, cochlea, or in neurons. And then there is the NKCC2 isoform, which is specific for kidney tissue, which I'm on the right, I'm showing the schematic representation of nephron, which is the building block of a kidney, and is the where the NKCC2 is positioned, and there it is responsible for salt reabsorption from urine. And as you can imagine, this transporter has been implicated in a variety of human diseases, from hypertension and renal disorders, which are linked to the like salt concentrations in your blood and urine, to stuff like deafness, neuropathic pain, various neurological disorders, and also various cancers. And it is the last part that was interested us in this project, because we are part of a larger project called ARES that's targeting brain cancer. And experimental collaborators in this project sort of alerted us to the role of this transporter in glioblastoma, which is the most common malignant brain tumor. And the treatment for these brain tumors is rather limited, in that the surgical removal is not enough, and then the chemotherapy is associated with various side effects and efficiency issues. And it was shown that the NKCC1 is linked to the tumor progression, in that they see an upregulated NKCC1 activity. Is then linked to the cell migration and resistance to cell death. And some preliminary studies have shown that inhibiting the NKCC1 in conjunction with applying a more traditional chemotherapy is shown to reduce the growth of the cancer. The problem here is that the existing inhibitors of NKCC1 are very, very poorly travel across the blood-brain barrier. And then you are introducing very severe side effects, because you are targeting the transport in all the tissues and you are causing issues. So there is a room for development and better inhibitors there would be better targeted for the main cancer. And that's what we wanted to do. And as with all projects that we start in the group, we first look at the mechanistic study of what we are looking before we start actually doing potentially drug discovery kind of studies. So we can answer also some biological questions and provide some complementary information to existing experimental data. So one thing that I want to first clarify is that I was using the term transporter, and that is to differentiate it from channels. So channels are also transmembrane proteins that can facilitate transport of substrate across the membrane. So they do it in a passive diffusion manner, just by having an electrochemical gradient suitable for the substrate. So these are essentially static structures, or as static as these large biomolecular systems can be. And a transporter, on the other hand, transports the substrate across the membrane with associated conformation change. So typically, we would recognize three states of these transporters: an outward open state where the substrate is where the substrate can attach to the transporter from the extracellular space. Then there is occluded state when the transporter cannot receive any more substrate, and then inward open state where the substrate is released into the intracellular region. And we are limited by the available experimental structures with these transporters. And in our case, as is in case for most transporters, we really only have the inward open state. So we are limited to studying at this point just the release of the ions into the intracellular space. But that still leaves us with plenty of questions that we can answer. First of which is, in what order do these ions exit the transporter? We are talking about four ions. They cannot all move at the same time. So is there an order in their diffusion? And if so, what is the order? And the question is also, do they use the same channel? There we have ions with the opposite charge. So it may be possible there are different channels. In fact, when the first structure was solved, they identified three possible exit channels. And this is something we can also answer from simulations. And then, of course, we want to know the mechanism of the individual ion transports and what are the key residues involved, which again is our information that can drive us in the further drug design part of the study. So here I'm showing the full structure of the NKCC1 transporter, which exists as a homodimer with each monomer having a transmembrane domain and then a rather large C-terminal domain, which are in the domain swept configuration. We saw that they are in the cross from each other. But from for our purpose for the study, we built a more simple, smaller model when we only took the transmembrane domain of one of the monomer units. We, of course, run a benchmark simulation, of course, of the full model to confirm that our smaller model is stable. It is. And so we move on with it. Here I'm also showing just a schematic drawing of the transporter with the highlighted inner cavity of the transporter with the ions in their approximate orientation. And because we are dealing with two chloride ions, to distinguish them, I'm labeling one as top chloride, TCL, and one as the bottom chloride, BCL. And I will use this schematic representation of the inner cavity throughout the slides. So this is the close-up of the iron binding sites. I will not go too much into detail, but I will just highlight that the chlorides are bound by the amino group coming from the backbone of the protein. And the positive ions, the sodium and potassium, are bound by the carboxyl oxygen coming from the backbone, as well as oxygens coming from various side chains. Now for the computational details, again, nothing super exciting. We are using molecular dynamics and metadynamics, which are really the workhorse methods in our field. Here are the force field details, which if somebody is interested, they are there. And our system, even though we use the smaller model, is still about 140,000 atoms. That includes the transmembrane domain, the membrane itself, and the full explicit solvent. And for our metadynamic study of these processes, we use two set of collective variables. First is just simple distance collective variables, where you are monitoring the distance of the ion to its respective binding site. And then we are using what's called volume-based CVs, or volume-based metadynamics, when you take the center of mass of your protein, and then you calculate the spherical coordinates of your ligand with respect to this center, and you use these spherical coordinates to sample the unbinding. This was a method that was proposed specifically to study ligand binding and unbinding processes. The only potential issue that we are facing is that we are working with three-dimensional CV space. So for the analysis and visualization, we are elevating the free energy surface onto just a 2D system. And we take the rho, which is the distance from the center, as one CV, and then we use a coordination number formalism to represent the number of contacts the ion makes with the protein. So this is our CV2. And first initial simulations we did was very simple, and actually I call it here a quick and dirty, and the idea was here to figure out the order of the dissociation. So we did it in a very simple way, in that we took the transporter with all four ions bound, and then we were using thermodynamics to bias all four of the ions using the distance CV and seeing which ion dissociates first. We are not really looking here for a nice converged free energy surface or information. We are really looking at just qualitatively which ion dissociates first. And to make sure that it's not just a random chance, we repeat it all these three times. And from this, we have an answer to our first question, which is the order. So we see that when started with all four ions, the first ion to dissociate is the bottom right in the pink. Then if you move to the transporter with the three remaining ions, the sodium, potassium, and the chloride, we see that the potassium is the next one to dissociate. But then we come to the last two ions, the sodium and chloride, the top chloride, and we see that now the situation is less simple. In fact, we see that now it's not clear which one dissociates first. In fact, they look like their movement is interconnected, which makes it a bit more difficult, but we'll come to that later. So now that we have the information about the order, we can in more detail look into the dissociation of the individual ions. And for this, we use the volume-based CV. So here we are looking at the dissociation of the bottom chloride from the transporter in the cavity. And here is the free energy surface with CV1 as the distance from the center, and then CV2 essentially number of contacts of the ion with the protein. And we can follow this process, and we see at the beginning the chloride starts to lose its coordination with the original binding site, so it loses the protein contacts and becomes more solvent exposed. Here the water molecules are represented only by the oxygen atoms as these red squares, so the chloride becomes more solvent exposed, potentially stabilized by this potassium in the bind. And then it slowly moves from the inner cavity outside and dissociates slowly. I won't go too much into the details, but I want to highlight the role of asparagines, specifically the asparagine 220, 298, and 427, specifically because we will see them later on. And we also see that the dissociation free energy of this ion is very relatively low, which makes sense that it will be the first one to dissociate. So now we move to the next step in the transfer process, which is the potassium dissociation. And again, the process starts with the potassium losing its coordination with the original binding site, but still remaining in the inner cavity and becoming slightly more solvent exposed. This process is associated with relatively low free energy, but then it has to leave the inner cavity and move to the exit part of the channel, which is then associated with relatively higher energy barrier, so it has to escape. And here I will again highlight the same asparagines that we saw before, but before they were involved in the chloride dissociation. Here they are helping the potassium dissociation. Then in the next step, the potassium is sketched by this glutamic acid. Then this is a relatively strong interaction with the negative protein residue and the positive ion. So again, this is associated with relatively high dissociation free energy. And then it again dissociates to the exit channel. And overall, we see that the barrier here is higher than the bottom chloride association. And now we finally move to the last two ions. And as I said, the situation is a bit more complicated. So we are talking about dissociation of the top chloride and the sodium. And because we saw previously that these are somewhat interlinked, we cannot really just sample one of them at a time. So we have to sample both of them in one simulation, which again, we can't really use the volume based because there will be too much CVs for us to handle. So we are back to using just simple distance CVs. So for on x-axis is the distance of the top chloride to its binding site, and on y-axis is the distance of the sodium to its binding site. And the rearranged surface is kind of complex, as we can identify three possible paths, which are schematically shown here. So in the first path, the sodium doesn't move. It remains in its binding site. And it's just the top chloride that moves and it dissociates on its own. This is associated with a rather large free energy barrier. Now the second path is more interesting because we see first the movement of sodium towards a new stable metastable minimum. And then from this, the chloride can move until it reaches this, let's say, branching point, from which again the path split into the path two, which just the chloride associates, or path three, where the chloride and the sodium associates together. And I will focus on more details on this first path, because for us is the most probable one or more interesting one. So as I said at the beginning, the sodium moves from its binding site to a new stable minima. And this is interesting because this represents the potassium binding site. The potassium dissociated previously, so the binding site is now empty. So the sodium can move to this, the originally potassium binding site. And the chloride can now dissociate. Now we can dissociate with a lower free energy than if the sodium didn't move. It moves past the sodium and reaches this point, which is the let's say the branching point, the P2-free state. And this is interesting because now the top chloride occupies the original bottom chloride binding site. So we are now in the state where the sodium is in the potassium binding site and the top chloride is in the bottom chloride binding site. And from here, the top chloride can now continue dissociation. And in fact, it will dissociate using the same pathway as the bottom chloride dissociated, which we have seen previously. Or we can see the movement of the sodium, which now moves away from now the potassium binding site, and then sort of stepwise the sodium, potassium, sodium and top chloride moves away until they dissociate. And again, in the red, I'm again highlighting the asparagines, which I talked before, which have so far been involved in all the dissociation processes. Now, this here I'm showing just a summary of the process, which is a schematic diagram of the whole CC1 ion transfer process. So it starts with the dissociation of the bottom chloride with a relatively low free energy barrier. Then potassium dissociates with, let's say, slightly larger free energy barrier. And then we come into the mess that is the dissociation of the top chloride and sodium, with the most probable path being that the sodium and top chloride move together in some intercoordinated coordinated way. Of course, we also investigated the possibility that it's the top chloride that dissociates first, and then the sodium has to dissociate on its own, but I'm not showing this due to the time constraints, but all these options were investigated, and most probably is this path highlighted in the red that represents the ion transport process. Now, as I have slightly spoiled in the subtitle, all four ions travel through the same channel, which is interesting because we are here dealing with ions with opposite charge. Here are showing the figures, hopefully it's visible, are the surfaces representing the volume occupied by the ion as it dissociates. So this is for the bottom chloride, potassium, top chloride, and sodium. And the question might be asked, how is it that in one channel you move both positively and negatively charged ions? And here I want to highlight these asparagines, which you have seen be part of the process of all the ions. And it makes sense that as the asparagines sort of ambivalent nature, they have a partial positive charge, through which they can interact with the chloride ions, with the negative charge. And they have a partial negative charge through which they can interact with the positively charged ion, the sodium and potassium. So we were hypothesizing that this may be like the the feature of these ion transporters, maybe even shared in other families. So we took a look at the simple sequence alignment of the two isoforms, F and KCC, as well as the KCC transporters. The KCC transporters are a related family of transporters that transport potassium and two chlorides, but no sodium. What we saw is that two of the asparagines that we identify as key are conserved among both of these families, while the one of them was really conserved only within the KCC1. So we are hypothesizing that this is potentially a common and important feature of these ion transport proteins. So to conclude what we have done, we have really used a very simple and straightforward workhorse method of biomolecular simulations to answer, I would say, relatively interesting biological questions of this transporter. We identified the order of the exiting ions as bottom chloride, potassium, top chloride, and sodium, or top chloride and sodium together. And this is also reflected in the fact that the later ions, the sodium, visits the now empty potassium binding site, while the top chloride visits the bottom chloride binding site, which is now been empty. We also see that all the ions have a fluorescent channel, which will be facilitated at least partially by the ambivalent nature of the asparagine residues. Of course, no scientific project is ever finished. They are just abandoned, and we are not abandoning this project yet. So there are ongoing efforts. First is to look at the full length dimeric model, because while we think that the small model we use is suitable for what we have done so far, there is still the question of what is the role of the dimerization, what is the effect of the dimerization of the dimeric transport, and what is the role of the rather large C-term domain. And of course, because ultimately the goal is drug discovery study, finding like new novel inhibitors of the system, we're also looking at the inhibitor interaction with the transporter. And for this, I have just a small sneak peek of what we are doing here. So we are looking at the role of the bumetanide, which is a loop diureticum, which is a drug that I think used to be prescribed against swelling and high blood pressure. I think it's no longer as commonly prescribed. And here I'm showing what we have as a preliminary binding pose of this drug inside the transporter, inside the inner cavity. What is interesting and what we see from the simulations, this partially collaborated from the literature, is that this inhibitor outcompetes or competes with the bottom chloride ion. So the bottom chloride is no longer bound, but it requires the presence of the other three ions for the interaction, which makes the let's say vitro screening and other studies a bit more challenging. Again, the workflow for this was again very simple, relatively simple. You start with the docked pose of your ligand, which you then can refine further in molecular dynamics simulations or in metadynamics to obtain like the true optimal minimal pose of your inhibitor, and then you can do binding kinetic calculations and look at the important key interactions that you can then target in more rational drug design approach. And so I will not go into any details, time constraints, but I will be available for the gather session if anybody has any questions about these type of studies, what we do here. So with that, I will end the talk. I will acknowledge the supervision of Alessandro Magistrato and the nice, friendly, collaborative atmosphere in our group with all the members. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Pavel, also for staying perfectly in time. So we have 5 minutes, let's say, more or less, for a few questions. So please go ahead.
I have a couple of questions, if I may.
Yeah, go ahead, Matteo. Yeah, sure.
Ciao, Pavel. Thanks a lot for the very nice talk. It was super, super interesting. I was curious about like the first part where you did like the quick and dirty simulations, no? To get an understanding of what was the order of the exit of the ions. So I was wondering, is like going to the second steps and then the third, like for the exit or the second or third ion, did you start your simulation like from where the first ones ended up, or like from the first initial one equilibrated and you removed the ions yourself? To understand it practically.
What you've done is the random metadynamics, then take the final structure from this with the ion that left, let it equilibrate again for a couple of nanoseconds, maybe even up to 100 nanoseconds, and then there was the starting point for the next metadynamics.
Amazing. Okay. And also another question I have is, like, during the metadynamics run, where you basically, like, at every round you choose like the proper variables to observe the exit of like, I don't know, like the bottom chloride and then the potassium and then the other two. In the case of the first one, for instance, no, you set your metadynamics enhancing the sampling of this ion here. I don't know, this affect in any way the binding of the other ions, or you had to put some restraints on those, or it went like smoothly, easily?
No, I don't. No restraints were really needed for the other ions. No.
Okay, so you were like, it was working rather well, just putting the enhancing sampling
of the ion. Yes, rather well, yes.
Okay, interesting. And also, this is just like a stupid curiosity, probably. At the end, you showed like for the next projects you have, like this inhibition, yes. So I was curious how you plan to, like after docking, which I more or less know how it works. I've used it a little in the past. I was curious about how you plan, or if you have some ideas on how to do the metadynamics post refinement in this case.
This is what I've already done, actually. I'm just now showing it. And for this, I have again used the volume-based metadynamics.
Okay, so similar practice to the one used for the ions.
Yeah.
Okay, cool, thanks.
No problem.
Thanks. Okay. One more question, maybe?
So
there is.
Yeah, I think Christian had his hand up, so he can
go ahead. Thank you, Pavel, for the presentation. My question is no. Sodium and potassium ion are transported by gradient concentration or by an energy needing on the transporter port, like ATPase, or what is the dynamic for some drug who intervene on that transport, like vancomycin? What is the dynamic of that transportation?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand properly. Are asking for
sodium and potassium are transported. What is the dynamic of the transportation? Is it a gradient of concentration, or is it by an energy, either on ATPase port or?
There is no ATP used here. It is driven by A, the ion concentration, and B, by the conformational change in the transporter. And there is a regulation mechanism where the transporter gets phosphorylated for it to function, but there is no use of ATP or anything like that anywhere in this process. If that's the question you are asking, I don't know if I understand correctly.
Yeah, thank you. It's okay.
Okay, thank you very much. So thank you very much, Pavel, again, for a very nice talk. So I